my, there. Oh, why do we want to turn that down?
Yeah, I don't have the mic.
Okay. No, but they want me to.
I know, like, they want you
on. I don't need a mic, but they need the thing.
Science, facilitate science activities in the Yukon, and also, as those of you who are here all the time know, that we also put on these talks. And we put these talks on in several places. We're funded for these talks by Department of Tourism and Culture, Heritage Branch, and we're supported, obviously, by the Beringia Center, who really go out of their way to host these. So I think I always, a lot of their staff put in a lot of hours. And last week they put in a lot of hours. So also, Yukon Environment provide funding that allow us to send some of our speakers out to some of the communities. And in fact, Ian here will be going up to Dawson tomorrow morning, right?
Bright and early.
Crack of dawn. So the one thing we want to really encourage people to do, because our funding is in a way tied when we put our grant applications in, is to our membership. So we very much encourage you to buy a membership. It's really an onerous $5 for an individual, $10 for a family. So I'm sure you can help us out on that. Next week, on Wednesday, March 2nd, we have this strange phenomenon called the fiscal year end. Half of you or three quarters of you have been civil servants. You understand these things. It takes us forever to get the grants to come at the first of the year, and then we've got to go like crazy. So anyways, we have a speaker coming in, Scott Pegot, and he's going to be speaking on the follow-up research on what's happened with the Exxon Valdez oil spill in Prince William Sound. And what's covering and what's not. And he'll also be going up to Dawson on March the 3rd. So it's actually this Wednesday, March the 2nd, this talk here. And then on March the 20th, sort of keeping on the marine aquatic, well, marine theme, Daniel Pauly from Victoria will be coming up talking about acidification of our oceans, the result of our climate change, and the impact on the wildlife and plants. As those of you know me, I can't read these things. The pipe's too small. Also, I can't read things. And then also, Daniel will be going up to Haines Junction on March the 21st. So our speaker tonight is Ian Glenn. I've known Ian for 10 years, about.
Yeah, about that, yeah.
We met during IPY. I actually had to embarrass him and introduce him at a session on technology during IPY. So it's the second time I've had to embarrass him. And he's going to be talking about the rise of the industrial drone. And I will try to read this because there's some important messages in here. According to Lori. Ian served as a Canadian Army Armored and Electrical Mechanical Engineering Officer for over 20 years before founding his first company, ING Robotic Aviation, formerly, when I first met him, known as ING Engineering, back in 2002. While with the Army, he began working with Transport Canada on aerospace management regulations and technical standards, and this work he continues to this day. In his final posting, he was responsible for Canadian Army's unmanned aerial vehicles and intelligence surveillance, target acquisition, kind of reconnaissance program. Did you know we had that? You might call it. While LNG surveillance support to the Canadian military is ongoing, Ian has expanded the company's focus to address the area. And underwater sensors needed for diverse sectors of law enforcement, forestry, mining, electrical, or electricity, oil and gas, engineering, what have you. And while he entered the private sector, Ian also saw a need for a common voice for unmanned aerial vehicle systems community, which led him to found an NGO of the Unmanned Systems Canada, a non-profit association representing their interests. Now, for those of us here in the Yukon, obviously, our involvement with First Nations is fairly extensive. Like, often they're doing some of the leading edge work. And one of Ian's latest ventures is a company called iRobotic Aviation, a Canadian Aboriginal business that delivers airborne sensing solutions using robotic aviation. I didn't know about this until I had to read this 10 minutes ago. I had to go check and make sure I had it right. Its main role is to create high-tech employment for Aboriginal youth and their community, enabling them to deliver services to resource companies and to government without having to use some. So for some of you, about 5 years ago, Ian was up here at the trade fair, YSI Club Trade Fair, and then after that, he with some folks from University of Alaska,
yes.
Remember right?
Yep.
Fairbanks, went out to Cousins Airport, put on a major demonstration. So he's not new to the Yukon, and in fact, at one time, may not talk about this, he actually had a Yukon employee. So.
Thank you very much.
Did I wreck you again?
Yeah, you did fine. You did fine, Ian. You did fine. Thank you. So thank you very much. It is a great honor to be here in the Yukon, Whitehorse. I got to see ladies throwing axes today. You don't see that every day. So thanks for coming on your Sunday night to listen to what I have to say. I'll cover a pretty wide range of things because guess what? Drones are a disruptive technology that have just, for us in the commercial sector and certainly in the consumer sector, like drones are everywhere, right? Everywhere there's drones. You can't pick up the paper without reading about drones this, drones that, drones the other thing. Well, this is my 20th year in the drone field. So but the Army, for various reasons, made me the guy responsible for their program in 1996. And that same year, I engaged Transport Canada at the Director General of Civil Aviation level and said, so if I had a drone, right, we called it unmanned air vehicle, but there's a lot of acronyms, UAVs, UASs, RPASs, UCAVs, you can name it. Anyway, drone we'll use, or UAV, or I like to call them robotic aircraft now, because I don't have to use any acronyms. I said, so what would happen if I took a military drone off and flew from Kingston up to Petawawa, which is a couple hours flight time, and then come back via Ottawa? And he had all, I was in the big room, and he had all of his chiefs and his directors there, and he thought about it and said, well, you'd have a military tail number, so not my problem. And he pointed to one of his chiefs and said, Arlo, you're it. And I worked with them ever since to help create some of the rules that we have today in various roles. But it's fascinating what we can do today with these robots that fly. And so I'm going to try and talk to you about some of the things we've done, how I got there. But as an example, this is a great example of things that you couldn't imagine doing. There's no flight deck. There's no helo deck off of this ship. This is MV Arctic. And this is a year ago, you know, with a week's notice when we got the contract, I put a team on board and we flew off of here and captured this image here and a number of other images. Really, really challenging, right? The ship is moving at, you know, 5 to 10 knots. It's minus 30. My guy outside, I've got another slide to show you a bit more, but you know, he's getting frostbite. And there's no helo deck. It's just they cleared away. There's like no anchor chains. You use this little bit of metal deck. That's where we operated from. And it was and winds were blowing at about 20 knots across the deck. So one of the most challenging environments, right? Now, everyone in the Arctic, in the Yukon or Calawit or wherever, you go, well, you know, it's really cold. Well, okay, now I know you're lying to me because it's colder in Ottawa than here. I'm walking around with my jacket open. That's like, no, but there's, you know, in Canada, we have a particular environment that we have to design for. So that's what we do, is we design for that. We heat our batteries. We do all kinds of stuff to try and allow our robots to fly in situations they wouldn't otherwise. And turns out we've been around it for a while, so we've got customers from Kenya to Chile to Alaska to Lithuania, so all manner of different places around the world, people are using our systems, which is delightful. And we've done a lot of operations in a number of different places, so I'll take you through that. But, you know, it's not all good news, right? Drones are everywhere, and lots of people are getting scared because of drones. So I like to, I think this next clip sort of gives you a perception of where we are in the drone world.
I think we can make it, right?
It's okay, Jim.
Just stay calm and move as quietly as possible. Everyone understand? No sudden movements.
Google search, Bodega Beach House.
Is that a diesel Audi? Anyway, so I got another view of the world, which is it's not so scary. I'll make the distinction between consumer drones and industrial drones. Industrial drones, to me, are tools that go out and we use them like we use ladders. The bush all day, you string the team out and you're walking along, but you're not gonna, you know, unless you stumble over there, cover the ground a whole lot more quick this way. We were at 5 yeah, 500 feet AGM on the ground, yeah, and it's actually executing a 400 meter radius from the launch site. Can you hear? Well, I can turn this down. That also work? Okay, thanks. So, that's the idea. So when you've got this view of the world, what can you do with it? Where does it apply? And these are just the ones. And, you know, I could put up film industry stuff, right? But, really the resource sector, and for here, mining, right? But mining, oil and gas, agriculture, where you want to get that last little, you want to improve, you know, another percent or 2% or 5% improvement in growth. You know, for those of us who live, you know, in where we get winter, like we only have a limited growing season. So can we use technology to help us improve our yields? Wildlife conservation, forestry, this ability to go out and map and look at things is key. I mean, examples around that. Emergency response. Yeah, so there was an article in the Globe and Mail, D&D's gonna go buy a killer drone. Okay, fine. They've been trying to buy a killer drone for 17 years. I know because I was there when we stood up the program. They've not succeeded yet. But there's real application here, floods, ice breakup, all that sort of stuff. Ice roads, there's a lot of reasons we want to do it. Large construction sites. We just did a nuclear facility in Ontario where we mapped it to 2-centimeter resolution into two dimensions and created a three-dimensional model. And then we've got utilities where we've got power transmission, power generation, getting a good look at things. I'll talk about all those. So I have this view of the world, for my company and how it all sort of ties together. But it starts with this deep sector knowledge, regulatory leadership. We do a lot of R&D. And then just as helicopters are a service, drones can be a service. And then we bundle stuff up to solve problems, and then we do training. So where do drones fit in? If you're mapping things, this is where, really good satellites, nice day, right place, 30-centimeter resolution, world something three, right? Manned aviation typically operates at about sort of same sort of resolutions, 30 centimeters. On the ground, you get great resolution wherever you are, right? But it's this here, when we sort of operate in the five centimeters to 1-centimeter resolution. That's kind of where we find a sweet spot for us to collect data. So I wanted to make this distinction around different things between consumer and industrial drones. When I looked at this, and I spent a long time at this, I invested in something in the order of $500,000 of military quadcopters, and they all failed me at some point. Because there's a technological limit to how fast you can speed up and slow down little blades. So, helicopters actually work. So if you take the advantage of a helicopter without putting somebody in it, because people are always dying in helicopters, we all lost friends, I'm sure, in helicopters, you got a great solution to go, and we just optimized to carry sensors. So our real workhorse is primarily our medium lift. And then this idea of wind. What's that? Oh, okay. I can do no pointer too. I don't want any epileptic challenges or Yeah, sure. I just won't use it. I don't need it. I'll just put it over here. And then I'll just be waving my arms more. Okay. Wind is a big. This is aerospace, right? This is things fly. So what are the big challenges we have? We have to fly in cold. To flying wind, those are the things where we tackle. So in this case, in the background, you see a responder doing a wind turbine, and I'll talk a little bit more about this, but the winds are 50 kilometers flying past this, without running into the blade. This is an important thing. So Ian mentioned quite an extensive experience. We were fortunate enough, every entrepreneur has their thing. Because of my 22 years in the military, I was pretty distressed, I think is a nice way to put it, about the lack of support for our soldiers in Afghanistan. So I teamed up with a little company out of the left coast of America, and we went off to Afghanistan, where we flew some 30,000 hours. So every day, we would put one of these little 10-foot wingspan drones over our troops, looking for bad people doing bad things. And that really was a significant contribution to keeping our guys safe. And then we had the opportunity to do that for the Navy. So I'm very proud of my team, and Greg Benoit, who's here, was part of that team. In fact, he's going to pop up here in just a sec. Oh, in fact, yeah, there's Greg. So you see him around town, he's now a realtor here in town. So this idea of this has been my passion, so that's why I know quite a bit about how the world works. So we were in Afghanistan, we had commercial operations, and we decided to build our own technology for the commercial market. And we went on to do work for the Navy, and so we built, as you now know, products and services. We've won some awards as the top organization in Canada, and for IEEE, for the top technology company in Ottawa. And we've done work for all of these customers. So this idea, what does 35,000 hours mean? At 50 knots, 70 kilometers an hour or so, that's like flying around the planet 81 times. So it gets, we spent a lot of time thinking about this. And how do you do that? So here's another little short clip. Now this helicopter you're seeing has got a rotor head about like that. For. I think three things. In the land of acronyms, I have a new acronym. I call it MIM. Monitor, inspect, and map. One of the issues they mentioned, it comes up all the time, is what about the rules? What are the rules of the road? There's a lot of rules. The first thing they did, I mentioned on the, CBC called me for an interview Friday. The first thing they did to the Minister of Transport, Mark Garneau, when he was sworn in, right after he was sworn in, they had him do a bunch of videos online about drones and drone safety, right? So there are rules. You should know what they are, which is good. Basically, you couldn't just go outside here and fly one because there's an airport right here. So these rules are all designed around keeping people safe. For those of us who are flying in and out of these things, I think is a great idea, right? So really, to go and do drones without any training, you should, if you walk off into the bush, you're probably fine, right? More than 9 kilometers from urban settings, from aerodromes, all that sort of stuff, that's a good place to go. But otherwise, there's a whole raft of things you should know. It's like you were going to go learn to fly a plane. You need the same sort of level. So you have to sort of go and get your, like a ground school for a private pilot, is kind of the level of knowledge you're expected to have if you're going to do this commercially. The FAA in the U.S. have adopted the same approach. So we're fortunate, well, I've been working on it for a while, but to be able to operate in all the provinces and territories and now in the U.S. So there are other companies, there's a new a fair number of companies now that are starting to create courses for consumers or folks who want to get in the business to learn about drones, so that's a good thing. Now, our particular approach is really around pickup trucks. I'm all about carrying sensors. So, and I'll do this really slowly. So, Serenity is our fixed wing. Responder is our rotorcraft. But really, it's all about what I call glass to glass, or this idea of camera to screen, right? And whether it's a elevation model or a heat map or a vegetation map or some kind of 3D thing, that's really the data that you're after. Like the air show is really boring. And it goes whoop, and it goes up and it goes really quiet and sometime later it comes back. So I'll talk a little bit about the products. These are all thermal images. actually from our custom down in Chile. It's primarily used for forestry and in legal logging, some of the challenges there. This is the fixed wing, so it flies right away. See the truck. With the zoom camera capability, watch as it backs up. We're a long way away, so that's a really useful thing. So we're working with Ministry of Natural Resources and Forestry in Ontario, where we're going to go look at the, we're going to do moose, count moose. So having that zoom capability, we're going to explore whether we can actually tell the gender, when we see a moose, whether we can tell the gender of the moose. I don't know if we can or not, but that's where we're at. So before, you had to take a helicopter, and which has an impact on the wildlife that you're studying. Now, without ever being detected, they won't notice. You'll be able to go out and have a look. So these are some kind of neat things that this level of technology brings. So this is a very portable system. This is the whole... now you've got me right. I was like, oh, I can't wave my thing around as much as I would. But basically, we've got packs in 8 boxes, 3 aircraft. You throw it in a Dash 8 into a Twin Otter or something like that, take it off into the bush and operate from there. So a highly portable system. Then we have our responder, which is a really flexible workhorse. And these are kind of the last images you'll see of the systems, because it's really all about the data. And it's about the kinds of cameras and sensors that we carry and the kind of data sets we produce. So a thermal camera, like this thermotechnic camera here, will allow us to see the temperature to 1/20th of a degree Celsius when it's calibrated. That's very neat stuff, right? So if you got a mining equipment and you want to go up and have a look at something, see if the bearings, what the temperature of the bearing is, right? Without sending somebody climbing up on a scaffold, you could do that. With just a straight Nikon prosumer camera here, we're able to produce these kinds of results. I'll talk more about these in detail. And with multispectral and hyperspectral cameras, now we can start to do even classification. So I'll explore these in more detail. Some new sensors we're just adding now, which are fascinating, GEM Systems out of Toronto, a magnetometer. So the ability to do surveys. So in the mining sector in particular, everyone, like I've been going to PDAC for a few years now, this is the Prospectors Developers Association of Canada, big mining show. It was like, can you do a magnetometer survey? Can you do a magnetometer? Well, yeah, actually now we can. So you can do it cost effectively, very localized, very high resolution, very safe, right? Similarly, people like LIDAR, so that's laser imaging distance and ranging. So flashlight, go bleak, and measure how long it takes the light to come and back. And we create a buildup of model, that's called a point cloud. We can do that sort of thing. And brand new is this ionizing radiation detectors. So the ability to detect radiation sources, certainly in some prospecting things, is valuable. And there are other uses for it. So this ability to host these systems and then just have the robot go back and forth. Other things we do. We developed a system to go and perch on top of the chimney and do the inside. This is a neat one. We did this in Alaska and then in Ontario. We built a system that will spray this herding agent. When you have an oil spill in the Arctic Ocean, what do? Well, right now you get your helicopter, you fly over 40 feet, and you spray this herding agent out. Problem with that is, anything goes wrong, you die. So what we proved is that with a solution like this, we can go out and spray exactly the right droplet size, exactly the right flow rate, and then, once you've done that, then you can actually light and drop a flare and burn it off. So a new capability where safety really trumps all. And then we talked a little bit about, ice route reconnaissance. So I talk a little bit about drones as a service, just as a model to compare to helicopters. I won't spend any time on it, but you know, it's, you know, this is a level of knowledge that's not for the faint of heart, right? You do have to spend some time. Transport Canada expects you to spend time. Everybody who flies expects you to spend time and have knowledge. So one of the ways to do it is to say, I need this knowledge, and someone will come and go get it for you, as you do hire a helicopter today. Just an example of an inspection task we did, which was wind turbines. So I happened to be on a panel with Rob with GE last year, and he said, could you like do this, take pictures? And I said, yeah. So we went and did it. And what we showed very quickly, and this is just to illustrate, if you can imagine it, you can probably go do it. You know, in this case, we went and collected 20 gigabytes of data about turbines, where these blades, they're meant to be really nice. But what happens is, of course, they get hit by lightning, they get hit by birds, they wear and tear. So optimizing those keeps the efficiency of the turbine up. We flew in up to 50 kilometer hour winds, and we saved the money, and we were much faster. This is what we proved. Here's another example of an industrial setting. As I'm talking about drones at work, so this happens to be a picture taken by a responder in the oil patch. This ability to go and look at things in detail up high and do it safely is important. But also, the horizontal, looking at those tailings ponds and dikes and all that sort of stuff, again, a great task for a robot. Then there's all of these roofs and things to go look at. Work at height is expensive in every industry. And then there's even more stuff that you can go and look, other towers and things that you could look at. So having a drone in these roles starts to make good economic sense. And again, if I relate it to mining and forestry and those sorts of things, perhaps there's a role here. And of course, my happy place is drones are everywhere, right? So, but that's my job. When we think of power and power transmission, we have a pretty good faith system. We have faith in the guys who get in helicopters and hang out the side to go look at stuff. It's crazy what people do. And then how do you inspect these lines? How do you deal with it? There's a forest fire. How do you go in and, you know, even during the forest fire, can you get in there and look at those transmission lines? Like, you depend on your power, so how do you get there? Well, a drone's a good way to do this. This is an example of some of the work we've done, where you see that cracked insulator, the missing bolts, the cotter pin that's not all the way in, right? So that's a neat use. And the same thing goes for our telecommunications, whether it's a radio tower or you know, a cell tower. This ability to go up and have a really close look at that as part of a preventive maintenance or whatever, then you know exactly what things have failed, which you need to bring with you. This is a good example of, I don't think you guys worry about it too much, but Energy East is a big debate. Well, the most important guy here is this guy here. He's the project manager putting in a pipeline from Enbridge. This is south of Camrose. So putting more capacity to move our natural resource somewhere. What was interesting about this is he's there going, it's below zero. We all underdressed. It was 11 knots of wind blowing down the right away. And he's going, could I just watch this? Like, if I had this, could I just watch this on the big TV in my office? And I'm going, yes, you could. And get this view of the world, right? So when you're, you know, any of these projects, you only see only so much. And those of us not involved in it are always concerned, like, what, you know, levels of transparency, et cetera. But when you have these views of the world, you can see whether or not people are respecting the environmental restrictions. You're able to ensure that, from a corporate perspective, occupational health and safety rules are being followed. I mean, before we could go out there, it was 3 hours of training, and I got, like, 7 stickers on my hard hat, right? People take this seriously. But now we have this way to go and view and verify. And my thought is, you know, just share this information with Friends of the Earth and everybody else. You know, if you're doing it right, just share it. And that might help with us in some of our infrastructure projects. When we have buried pipes, this is where agriculture comes across into just our ability to monitor our pipelines. We have 850,000 kilometers of pipelines in Canada, and some of them are getting quite old. So one way to do it is something called MVDI, Normalized Difference Vegetation Index. So we take pictures in red, green, blue, which we're all kind of familiar with, and then a little bit up in the near infrared, a couple of near infrared bands. And by adding, if you're a biologist or someone actually, or an agronomist, you can add and subtract these bands. And what it turns out is you can start to see unhappy plants from happy plants. So when you apply it to this, which is a pipe under here, pipelines running under here, you know, go along, and maybe the first time you see that you've got a leaking pipe is because there's unhappy plants, where there weren't unhappy plants before. So that's so much better than the way we typically do it now, is a guy on a quad drives along and goes, oh, there's a big black lake of stuff here. That's not good, right? So we have things we can do to improve the world. Just using photogrammetric techniques, you can achieve a high level of accuracy. And I mentioned this power plant we did, but this is just a wharf that we've done for the Canadian Coast Guard. So this is a blow up over here, is a blow up of over there. This is created just by taking a bunch of photos and processing them to create a point cloud and then colorizing the point cloud. It's very cool. Like, I think it's just amazing what you can do. Now, if you extrapolate and we talk about environmental monitoring, environmental protection, this is 24 square kilometers of Grasslands National Park in southern Saskatchewan. And Environment Canada had us go out and map it at 4 centimeter resolution. So that's about 4 centimeters, right? And why? Because the sage grouse is completely dependent on the sage bush. And the sage bush, by being able to create a map in 2 and 3 dimensions at this level of resolution, the scientists were able to go, when the snow came, they went, it's now higher than the sagebrush. Now these species at risk, we need a new plan. But if you extrapolate from that, this three-dimensional model here, you can think of all the floodplain mappings and all the other types of analysis that you might want to apply when you have this kind of data set. And so we did this up in Cujuac, up in northern Quebec, where we did, again, 4 centimeter resolution data set. And this is a 10-minute flight. So it's amazing how fast you can create data sets, or you can go acquire the data. Yes?
Are you including a collection of the elevation data in that, you said, with a 10-minute flight? Is that included in the...
So it takes longer to produce it. But the collection part is only 10 minutes. And then we have automated processes that create a digital elevation model, a digital surface model, and then finally drape the orthomosaic on top. Yep. And I think it's cool because it's like, looks, reminds me of mist. What are we looking at? This is the harbor for Cujuac, is what it is. And there's the fuel tanks for the community over here. The community itself is over to the right. And what's interesting is we actually produced some bathymetric data just because of the low turbidity of the water. So that was pretty fascinating. I mean, in that littoral range, it's kind of neat what you can do.
So is there any leak, so you can see on the picture, is there any leak from the tanks or anything else?
Oh, you would see that too. Yeah, I mean, remember at 4 centimeters, if I left my iPhone on the, you know, someplace I could find my iPhone, right? Those are the size of the pixels, not this size, right? So you've got lots and lots of resolution to go and look for things. We've done, we did the bitterns off of the coast of Delta BC and the Sunshine Coast. And I didn't put that slide in, I meant to. We proved with the environment, with the Canadian Wildlife Service guys, that we could collect over top of them. So not just their habitat, but because we didn't disturb the birds, we actually have some, I can pull this up later, I guess, if anyone wants to see it. the thousands and thousands of these little birds, they're like a sandpiper type thing, on the water, and you never get that picture anywhere else. Like if you fly over them, then with a manned aviation, they all, swarm away. You're not gonna get it from satellite. And typical technique is, I think, look through a binocular and sort of go, yeah, there's like a thousand there. What we were able to do, or what they were able to do, and we wrote a paper with them, is prove that we could fly as low as 100 feet above them without any disruption. And now you can apply, like I'm a digital signal processing kind of guy, you can apply image processing techniques, and I can give you an exact count of how many birds are there. I mean, you just couldn't get this data before. And in fact, that was our sort of deduction. It was like, yeah, we've been kind of doing it wrong. So fascinating what you can do.
Is 4 centimeters an optimum elevation?
Or could you advance it a larger number like a 6 or 8? So that's a question for the guy who needs the data. And it always is. Right? So if you're happy with 6, we'll collect at 6 because it's faster. Right? If you need 1, we'll get you 1. It's like the moose thing. So there's a cost, right? You know, there's a difference between 2 centimeters over 20 square kilometers, or 2.5, or 3, in terms of overlap of pictures. How many pictures, like 8,000 pictures instead of, or you know, maybe it's 5,000 pictures instead of 8,000 pictures to crunch through. These are not necessarily time sensitive, so you can, whatever you want, you're the customer, whatever your science demands might be the thing. For the least bittern, it probably, because they're only about this big, you probably want 4 centimeters to cover, make sure you get at least 1 or 2 in the, 2 pixels per bird kind of thing. But it's a science design question. Yes. Yeah. So again, it's what are you trying to achieve?
Yeah.
And work back from there. So it's about mission design, experiment design. That what it is you've got a tool now that'll go and get that for you pretty safely, right? And yes. Well, no, that was the point. That was the point of the exercise. That I said, for those birds, it's true for the, you'll see a polar bear picture too. We're able to fly, collect the data at the resolution necessary without any impact on the species and observation being observed, right? So, well, in fact, we actually did that. So we flew down and sort of worked out that, yeah, at about, if as long as you stayed above 100 feet, no impact. Pardon? That's a very good question. But below 60? It's a dB of distance, right?
No, I'm talking the machine.
Oh, the machine, well, measured right at it? Or?
When it fly, I guess you can change the speed, but what's the average noise the machine makes?
So, really quiet. So I had a dB meter. I have to say, I had the dB meter. We were flying the other day, and it was a snowstorm and wind and stuff like that. And we never got around to just confirming what it was. But it's not a lot. Like, yeah. So what was more of interest to me was when the Canadian Wildlife Service guys and my scientist actually were flying it, it was the observed result was not disturbing it. I could get you that number. Yeah, but that's why I say it's kind of boring, because it's really quiet. So you don't, once it takes off, it's gone and you don't hear it.
That's the helicopter?
That's the helicopter, yeah. And I will tell you, from 35,000 hours flying the other engine, no one, and we would fly sort of 3,000 feet, 3,000 feet above Afghanistan, and nobody ever looked up. So, yeah. When you have these new data sets, Now you can start to do even more cool stuff. So this is a project funded under the ENGAGE program from NSERC with Trent University. What we did is we looked at bush. Well, actually it was field and bush with a multispectral camera. And what they did was develop algorithms that would classify the crowns of the woodlot. And I thought, well, that's really cool. I wouldn't have thought of that. But using the same techniques, right? So we actually mosaic each of those bands, do some comparison, contrast, some image processing, and some analytics. And it allowed this level of classification. And how else are you going to do that? And what's the value of that if you're in the forestry industry, right? You know, and I know, I was looking at just in the paper yesterday, in BC, they're putting a whole bunch more into their forestry program around fire prevention. But, you know, between infestations and all the other things that come with this, now we have the ability to go collect data and classify. And, you know, just from an economic thing, if white oak is your thing, you know, you can say that 20% of my woodlot is white oak from a harvest management perspective. But also, if I add in LIDAR data, where I'm able to penetrate to the ground and from the top, now I'm able to actually get the size of the trees. I know what species they are. And so I'm going to have a really good idea now of biomass. And I think that's pretty cool. Around like this?
Yeah.
Yeah, probably. This is just a standard Ontario farm. So field.
Oh, 10 acres.
Yeah, something like that. It's not a big, particularly big place. It's probably a house down here, maybe someplace. Yeah. Other cool things, and nobody, like, we were talking about wildlife photographers, and the famous ones all from the Yukon. Well, I got my own. I got this picture. So this picture, I think, is pretty cool. It was taken, and this is the original frame. You can actually see the footprints of the bears in the ice, which is kind of neat. And, you know, who gets the picture of mama and the two cubs, right? Again, we're flying in 50-kilometer winds gusting off of Hudson's Bay. It's up in Churchill, flying off a tundra buggy. So not, you know, and this is one of those things where three other UAV companies had come up and crashed and burned before us, and we just got it done. And the point of this wasn't this picture. The point of this was actually to fly high-resolution multispectral to see whether you could take that data set and compare it to satellite-based multispectral to see if you could do help feature extraction out of the satellite data. I think the challenge they had with the multispectral was they never actually got good weather from space to collect the data they needed. But we were pretty happy about this. And Canadian Wildlife Service and Polar Bear International, and we're very excited by the results. And again, didn't bother the species at risk. So we got pictures of 17 different backgrounds and other things. It was pretty cool.
What's your elevation here?
Probably 400 feet. I think it was probably about 400 feet. We sort of operated at about 400 feet or 900 feet, typically, depending on how big an area is, but it was probably about 400. I mentioned the moose thing. This is a really boring job, right? So can you imagine a manned or a helicopter guy given the task to go and collect this data? Go back and forth. This is what it'll be, over 5 hours, a photo every 1.68 seconds. It's going to be 30 strips, about 8,600 pictures. This is a job for a robot. It's not a job for manned aviation. Because we can do it this way, and so the fixed wing will fly for 8 hours, so including transit, going out, we can go do this. This is not magic, it's just a job, right, for a robot. Go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Then post-process that imagery to give you, in this case, they want an ortho mosaic because they want to be able to see, can we see big moose footprints in the snow? Okay, let's go figure it out. So that's what we do. That's the kind of data set where we do that. Hopefully in a couple weeks. Emergency response, there's always flooding. There's always this, there's always that. This is 2 years ago, the river in Sherbrooke rose 27 feet. And you can see it cut off the lines of communications. It split the town, right? So this data was used in real time by the emergency responders to evacuate over 600 people. Just a little bit more on this. This was the deck we had to operate from. Just a challenging place. And we do, so the launch was here. Then we'd hand over to the operator back up on the bridge, who was feeding real time to the captain of the ship and to the ice, the guy doing the finding the routes through the ice. So really challenging. The view from the bridge of the guy in the front was like this little yellow dot down here, right? So five stories up, 240 meters back. Really, really challenging mission. Well, we went up, up around here and into Desolation Bay. The ship was picking up nickel concentrate from Ragan Mines. Actually, that the biggest challenge with calibration is you're on a steel deck. So having spent all that time in the Armor Corps driving around in tanks, I never used a compass then either. Yeah, so there's things about you have to understand your technology and about, but that wasn't an issue at those latitudes. Now we're further north here, I think. But and you can, as long as you understand what the challenges are, you can design to deal with that, right? So you can put more trust in your GPS direction, north finding, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Right, so you've got a couple ways to know. Remember, from a technical point of view, the autopilot doesn't know where it is. It's only got the inputs that it knows, right? So it's got a model, mental model of what it's doing. You know, flopping around like this. And one of the primary inputs is GPS. So the GPS tells it where it is exactly, or within the errors that GPS, whatever level of GPS you're using. And it's got a compass that's also, like your iPhone has a compass, right? That tells it what direction it is. So yes, as you go further north, obviously, that's why in airspace terms, in the northern airspace zone, we only use true north, not magnetic north, right? So then you just need to make sure you design for that, set things up. Yep, but you absolutely, that's a challenge, yep. The other thing we did with this was to deal with the real cold, we developed a battery warming technology, because it's lithium polymer batteries, so we developed a battery warming technology. So those batteries thought they were, in Maui, and not on the bow of that ship. So, you know, they thought they were warm to 38 degrees and it was minus 30, right?
Was that heater on board or were they warmed up before being
sold? And it kept them warm right to the point where it was time to go. So that way you've got lots of time to do your pre-flight checks, no one's rushing, it's safe, right? And then just remove the shore power and off it went and it was good. It's a very low discharge rate, so no. So yeah, that was my first time. Oh, that'd be no. It's like everything else, you know. If you got your mobile phone out in your hand, even if it's not, even if it's 50% charge, it'll just stop, because it happened to me in the snow. It just happened to me last week. And I went right. Must keep inside body, right? Body warm. What Canadians all know, but this is important, so you don't fall down. Right, so I've give me a sort of comprehensive view of the world. We started with Amazon. You saw packages being delivered. That's the big thing. I don't know why it's a big thing, but it is. Anyway, I just say thank you, Jeff Bezos, for making drones a popular word as opposed to spy drones, killer drones. Now we just talk about drones as really cool things, and like a million were sold in the US, and it's all exciting. But there's other practical things. You know, there's places where, you know, delivering emergency supplies or, you know, it's the kind of thing you can do. So that's my talk. I want to thank you. I open the floor up to any and all questions. Yes?
Both your vehicles are electric?
No. No, the fixed wing is a high-octane gas. It's a C10, which apparently, I learned this in Iqaluit, it is a favored fuel for snowmobile racers. Who knew? Yes? That depends on what you need. So if you just... so we are building a machine right now with two frequency, like L1, L2 differential RTK GPS. And so if you look at Trimble or any of those GPSs, that sort of caliber, that you can have that if that's what you need. The typical one is the same as sort of your iPhone, right? Or that level of, you know, we know where it is within a couple of meters, because that's sufficient for navigation. Yeah. And you can post-correct, you can also post-correct data. We use, so if you just use one frequency, pretty straightforward GPS, it's pretty good. But if you want, if your data set that you need needs to be of a higher precision, then there are other GPS solutions that you can add in, include like real-time kinematic. For the fixed wing, we use a differential GPS. And so we can tell when you do the corrections, we know where the aircraft is to sort of the volume of my thumb. It may be flying, like, and where, and depending on the weather, it'd be flying in a box about a meter on a side, sort of. Yes. So, in fact, we have a partnership with the Centre Géométrique de Québec, which is a nonprofit organization in Quebec. They're building us a state-of-the-art LIDAR right now. We'll be flying it this summer.
Do you fly
at nighttime? You can fly at nighttime. So, technically, the robot doesn't care, right? It just doesn't care. So it we require permission from Transport Canada, which we've done in the past. We've done counter moose jacking. You know, there are times we want it. So we fly with strobes and with other aviation markings.
Why are the consumer drones all these multi-rotor affairs, whereas obviously you're focused on better technology here? So what's the
cheap like Borscht. It is so easy to build a quadcopter. In fact, I know you guys have a makerspace. You can go 3D print your thing. I'm a big fan of the Raspberry Pi. Are you familiar with this little $25 computer on a chip? Comes out of the UK, right? The latest, the Magpie, that's the little magazine. If you go online, you can. There you go. The little $25 chip. Little motors, electric speed controllers, you're done, right? You got everything you need to go build yourself a quadcopter. So what that means is the Chinese have been selling us quadcopters, jacking up the, you know, I mean, they're spending $100 and we're spending $5,000. Yeah, good for them. It's good for their economy. I guess they need a boost. But it's because it's really simple. The processing power, it now exists in, you know, $5, 5 cent chips, right, to allow you to fly.
So a single helicopter is much more complicated control system, is that what you're saying?
Well, yeah, so it's got a helicopter fly, flies at a constant velocity. And so you change the pitch, right? So it is very, very good at doing that. The autopilot's got three actuators to move the swash plate, and it's got one that moves the tail rotor, and that's it. That's what it got. So the way an autopilot flies an aircraft is it says, well, I'm here, I've been told to go to here. And then it knows what it can do. So in a quadcopter, it says, I want to go over here, so I'm going to speed up these ones, and I'm going to slow these ones down, and that will get me going this way. And it measures itself, and it gets there. In a helicopter, it angles the swash plate, moves, and off it goes. It can go this way, up, you know. So it's just a really good design that's been around for a long time, well proven. So that's why we use it. It scales nicely. And it's very good in the wind. So it can react to wind gusts, wind shears, much more quickly than quadcopters can. Has been my experience, anyway.
Back here.
Sorry. Yes?
I was wondering if, when you were in Afghanistan, did anyone ever try to shoot your drone down?
No. Again, it's like, it's teeny tiny. It's like, you know, 20 kilos. This little tiny, like, teeny tiny thing, once it's 3,000 feet above you, you don't hear it, you don't see it. Yeah. Early stages, I would say. I have, I'm actually going up to a First Nations community off of James Bay next month. To run a drone training program and actually go up and map some ice and map some ice roads. Yeah, so it's like these things like, really? No, seriously. You know, we've got, you know, from a, as I like to say about folks that are good at this stuff, any kids, and there's some, I'm sure some very clever ones in the audience here, you know, with the, if you ever watch anyone do World of Warcraft or build Minecraft stuff, like they have three-dimensional view through a screen. That's a great place to start to learn to fly, communicate with this autopilot, and make it go. Have it do what you want to do. So I think it's just a matter of time when folks sort of go, really? Yes, really. You don't have to be a helicopter. You don't have to spend $180,000 in your education to become a commercial pilot. Do this. No. With the right technology in your hands, now you can go, if you do it safely, you're gonna have some great products out of it. I'll go back there, I guess.
Just a couple of questions. The responder, what's your crew's airspeed typically on that? And range and time? And you talked about the 30,000 hours, so what's the reliability factor? Obviously probably had some mishaps.
Yeah. No, that's what it is, right? So responders designed to fly when cruising for about 40 minutes. And so from an aviation perspective, we always keep a reserve, right? Its top speed is 72 kilometers per hour. It doesn't much matter. It's sort of how quickly, you know, it's back to that optimizing the data acquisition piece. Like, you can fly at that speed and collect still frames without any problem. So it goes, it's quite stunning when it's flying around the skies. Like it's just winging itself around, and it's like, wow, that's kind of cool. The total range, like the range is somewhat dictated by flight time and how big a radio you want to put on. So we've a couple systems in flying in Africa where for the last 2.5 years, and they were designed to go 10 kilometers and back, right? So that's that sort of range. And reliability. So all of these systems, remember, are, it doesn't matter whether it's military or not, they've all been designed to just kind of get the job done. Remember, from a safety point of view, from an aviation perspective, in manned aviation, the probability of death starts with one and goes to how many people are on board and then how many people you can hit when you hit the ground. In unmanned aviation, it starts at zero and it stays at zero, right? Until you run into somebody in the sky or somebody on the ground. So it's an inherently much safer thing. So now we're really just talking about my tools. So when something goes wrong, what's the probability I'm going to break my tools? And that's really where you sort of look at it as a commodity, right? And what is it going to cost me to fix it if something happens? So but you don't build in, like you don't gold plate anything, right? So there are redundancies for flight safety around communications and known behavior when you lose link or lose GPS or whatever, right? So those are emergency procedures that you're allowed to do things to recover the aircraft or keep the airspace safe is the primary objective in any of these things. So I always look for the fixed wing in more than 1,000 hours meantime between failure is where I'd like to be. Sort of the same for the rotorcraft as you get. But again, there's a lot of factors on how much you're pushing pushing the technology in the environment, right? Because if it's a search and rescue thing, you may well launch and go and look for someone with the expectation you may not get it back, right? Because it might just save someone's life. And then conversely, when I'm flying over nuclear power plants, I am really, really conservative about what we're doing, right? Because it's pain, things fall down, it's inside of, there's lots of things you just want to do. You don't want to fall down over that. So the reliability is, and it's still being, it's the kind of thing you design as much as you can, and then you just try to, as you find things, you can improve them. But electric motors are inherently good, right? Autopilot's getting better and better and better in terms of the speed at which they calculate where they are and what they need to do. A lot of the components have been used for millions of hours in other things. So that's kind of how you arrive at this is safe to fly. But unless you drop it on your head, no one dies. Okay, yeah, so I really do need someone to monitor, because I'm looking into this late as well, so.
Thanks. I'm a commercial operator in the operator here.
Yep.
I'm doing a lot of things with mapping the elevation, the imaging.
Yep.
I've got my social bike operations certificate for military.
Yep.
And that's more of a regulatory question, because people are into technical details, but I need to know your service with the
Unmanned Systems Canada, yeah.
And your work with Transport Canada, how is the regulatory thing going to be changing since regulations are under review?
So, the way these rules came about, Unmanned Systems Canada, I founded the association in 2002 and then ran it till 2008. The association has taken a leading role in helping Transport Canada actually move forward, right? Dragging and kicking, because how could there possibly be robots flying in our skies? Well, they kind of missed that one. But anyway, so what we've been doing under KRAC, which is a Canadian Aeronautical Regulatory Advisory Committee, is how the airspace rules in Canada are changed over time. That's that committee. Right, so it's an open committee. When you're elected into a working group, so it's got government guys, like it's got Transport Canada guys, it's got other government guys, it's got academics, it's got industry, and we all came together. So 6 years ago, we started working on the rules that are in place now in terms of the special staff instructions, and what that meant was we sort of broke the world up into under 25 kilograms. Within visual line of sight. So whenever you're flying a drone, somebody has to be the eyes of that Cessna pilot looking out, going, okay, there's nobody around, okay, we're good. We use two people to do that because I'm just sort of hyper cautious about being able to do this because you never know when that helicopter guy pops up and that happens to us. So that was that set of rules. Those rules then went out, they created an proposed amendment to the Aeronautics Act. That's what was promulgated last summer they're taking the feedback from that, and they're going to change the Aeronautics Act sometime in the next year, maybe. What that requires is it goes to those changes in the Aeronautics Act go to the Department of Justice. They get gazetted, and the rules will change. So you, as a commercial operator, will not require a special flight operating certificate. You will have the ability to operate without one, as long as you have proven that you've got an aircraft that's suitable for flight, that you are suitably trained, and that the mission is within your capabilities. Right? So that's what that means. So a year from now, perhaps you won't need to apply to Winnipeg for your special flight operating certificate. Now, the next one is beyond visual line of sight, right? And that's, to me, the big one. This is the one we all really want. Now, the stakes are higher, right? Because we're going well away, and how do we deconflict with other airspace users? Well, it turns out there's a technological solution, and that solution is already, with your neighbors in Alaska, been shown to be outstanding, and that's a transponder, it happens to be called Automatic Dependent Surveillance Broadcast, that Alaska adopted in 1999 and immediately saw a dramatic reduction in the amount of man-on-man aviation accidents. So, and in the US, if you want to fly in controlled airspace, which is most of their airspace in the lower 48, by 2020, so in 4 years from now, 3 years from now, everyone's going to have that in the US. So, ask Transport Canada what they're doing, and they'll go, oh, yeah, we're not even thinking about it. Okay, no, wrong answer. The right answer is everybody's going to do this anyway, right? If anyone wants to fly down to Arizona, you know, get into Florida, all the private pilots are going to add this. The price has come down to the price of my laptop and my iPhone. So there's a technological solution, and it isn't what you think it is, which they immediately think it's, you know, because the system was originally designed to replace these aging radars. So, you know, so it transmits, it's a little ping that says, here I am, this altitude, this place, space and time, and that gets transmitted to the ground and ends up on some scope. What's really cool is that all these radios talk to each other. So instantly, everyone who's flying, manned or unmanned, can tell each other where we are. Now we solve the problem, like we're done. So I like to say that there are five times as many cars in my in Orleans, a suburb of Ottawa, as there are manned aircraft in Canada. So this is something that the government could very rapidly change by just simply saying, here, here's a tax credit, get yourself sorted out. And now you and I can safely fly beyond visual line of sight. Yeah.
So if you're flying one of these aircraft,
yeah,
in an area, say, with ewes and lambs, and the interest is not in wildlife, but you happen to be flying low over those ewes and lambs, and they're responding as if it was an open eagle.
So I don't know that there are guidelines. I think there's been certainly some scientific study, one of the ones like that Bittern thing we did, which indicated that they habituate really quickly, like really, really quickly. Depending why you would be there in the first place, I mean, it's so much better than flying a helicopter at those altitudes to carry that sensor to do that. But it doesn't look like that. Number one, at the end of the day, it looks quite different.
I think the fixed wing would be the one that they'd be concerned.
But you'd be much higher. Like you're not, like much higher, like 1,000 feet. 10 feet at 1,000 feet, you can do them, somebody can do the math for me. But it's a little tiny thing in the sky. So it's, in my mind, I've not seen it as scaring a lot of critters, nor have I ever seen that as an issue. But there are no guidelines I'm aware of. There might be some environmental areas where that, you know, would be part of it. And part of this process is, quite frankly, you know, going and making sure that you're doing this safely and not causing a disturbance, right? I mean, there's a lot of yahoos in the world who might not look at the world that way, but this is meant to be something for good. Yeah, you had your question for a while there.
I have a question. Touching in Africa is a big issue.
Yep.
Have you gone into that market, or is it not a commercial market?
So I'm a Canadian. Of all the things I've attempted to do, that's not one of them. I'm somewhat passionate about the use of the technologies that we have to prevent that. Our systems that are flying in Africa are used more on safety and security side than animal security. Equally, it's a great application. I actually had a fairly large nonprofit come and visit me, maybe it's 4 or 5 months ago, specifically on this topic, and it was really from their perspective, you know, when their funding would be in place, kind of thing. But it's an ideal use, I think. You know, the ability to fly at night, thermal, you know, looking for bad people doing bad things, yeah, it works.
My question is there a sensor that can measure permafrost?
Measure permafrost? If there's a sensor that my question is there a sensor that measures permafrost? And then is it small enough size, weight, and power that I can carry it? I know for ice thickness, for instance, there is synthetic aperture radars, and there's some very clever ones that are like in the 2 pound range that, depending which band you want to be in, like in a UHF or a KU-KA band, different characteristics, you can potentially distinguish new ice from multi-year ice, and potentially, if you can put enough power through it, and carry enough power to do it, you know, sort of measure down to maybe 4 meters. Now, I don't know enough about permafrost to answer that question. But you find me the guy who's the permafrost guy, ask him to call me, and we'll see if we can build the thing that'll do that. And did I use my Walt Disney quote? No, this one? So, as I used it on the radio the other day, because I think it's a good one. Walt Disney used to say, he coined the term imagineering, right? If you can imagine it, we can engineer it. And that's really what the space is. That's why it's so disruptive, right? I mean, I only showed you what we're doing. I mean, there's lots of people doing other things, but there's a fascinating ability now to have this third dimensional view of our Earth, right? And that's kind of cool, you know? Because you can ask that question and I can tap dance around it, but you might ask something that I actually could do, but and maybe there's a way with multispectral and thermal and you know, LIDAR and just straight photography that we could produce a multispectral view of that area, and you could deduce what the permafrost thickness was. Well, I typically say, for what you pay for that hour of helicopter time, I'll work all day. The rest we can haggle, but it's disruptive both from an economic point of view and a capability point of view. it's customer driven. So literally someone came to us and said, could you inspect the inside of the chimney, right? And I went, well, I could design a quadcopter that could do this, and I could give it a little sensor so it wouldn't run in the walls, but it'd be little, really tiny cameras and have to light it. And I didn't show it because, but what we did is we think of Ethan Hunt, Mission Impossible. Helicopter goes, lands on top, and magic camera system goes up and down on it, right? That's, yeah, what do we do, right? It's like, what's the problem? Okay, I need water samples. Okay, so here's the problem with water samples. It's slung load, right? But I talked to someone actually in the Yukon, and he had to go collect a liter from each of these things, you know, every month, and it's an expensive and time-consuming thing, right? Okay, so I'll go out. Like, it's a helicopter, it's a robot, and yes, I can put a thing on that will, you know, collect water. If you want to collect water samples, yeah, well, probably a lot of water samples we could collect. Okay, yeah.
Fronts and how they're being biodegraded through the 1 year that these waters in the retention system. And the question came up, well, how come you aren't sampling in the winter? Well, you can't get out there with the community safely. So this kind of technology might actually work for that.
If there's one question, who's the youngest in the audience? Right there? Do you have any questions? Do you want to fly drones? Maybe. Sounds like a plan.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.